day is it, son? What day?
Sunday.
It's time to play the game. Time to play the game.
Get ready for a game day edition of CBJ and 30.
Game on!
Yeah, game on!
Hear from the players and coaches as the Blue Jackets get set to hit the ice. Join the discussion on Twitter by using the hashtag CBJ and 30. Here's your host, Bob McElligott.
Oh, it's a great white north, and it's snowing because it's Christmas time. On the first day of Christmas, my true love gave to me a beer. On the second day of Christmas, my true love gave to me two turtlenecks and a beer. On the third day of Christmas, my true love gave to me three French toast,
two turtlenecks,
and a beer.
Okay, that should be more there, right?
Where?
Fourth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me 4 pounds of back bacon,
three French toast,
two turtlenecks,
and a beer
in a tree.
See, you need more. The fifth day of Christmas, my true love gave to me 5 gold.
Take off, eh, you hoser. All the great sounds of Bob and Doug McKenzie and the 12 Days of Christmas. We are in the Great White North, Edmonton, Alberta. Blue Jackets and the Oilers are going to get together for the first time this season here tonight. We went over to the building this morning. I hesitated right there because I don't know exactly what direction I want to go. So I decided to go in the favorable direction to get this started today. We went over to the new building this morning, the Rogers Place. Very nice, but very lacking of character that the Rexall Place had. And I guess that's what you get when you have these old buildings disappear, even though they are, many of them are garbage. I mean, the Joe in Detroit, it's just not a fun place to work. It's not a great place, but it has character. And all of the new places look like each other. I mean, this building is very nice, but it looks like Pittsburgh, looks like Dallas, looks like Glendale. You know, it just loses that feel that the old place had. And I didn't even go all the way upstairs today. Just stayed down in the dressing room area. Went to the Oilers dressing room. Went to the Blue Jackets dressing room area. That was it. That was a long enough walk, for crying out loud. I learned that I've got to hustle. I've got to hustle to get from the bus to the dressing room and vice versa, because it's a pretty long walk here. But other than that, we went over and, you know, looked around a little bit. And I believe that's why John Tortorella had his team go to the rink this morning, to be honest with you. He's been out of the morning skate routine now, but I think that he wanted them to go over and be enamored in the morning, not to be enamored with the building later on this afternoon. So that's what they did. They went over, they had a meeting, some of them skated, some of them didn't, but they had a chance to go look around and try to acclimate themselves as best you can, just an hour or hour and a half. But they got to acclimate themselves a little bit so that when they come in tonight, they know where they're going, what they're doing, where to find the things that they're looking for. So that was a good thing. Now, the reason I hesitated a minute ago when I was starting this is because the Blue Jackets come into this game 7-1-2 in their last 10 games. They've won 6 straight games. They're playing very well. And reading some of the stuff that is being written by the Edmonton writers, they're already trying to set it up to where if the Oilers are to lose this game tonight, there's a good reason for it, and that reason is fatigue. We can talk about that in just a little bit. Let's talk about the Blue Jackets first and the fact that Nick Foligno will be back in the lineup tonight with his team. Nick missed the last 2 games because of illness. The Blue Jackets were able to win those games, and that was very, very important that they were able to do that. Oliver Bjorkstrand came up from Cleveland, got into the lineup, went right on the top line with Brandon Saad and Alexander Wennberg. Did a good job, but now it looks like he's back on the outside looking in. He did make the trip because when you come out west, you bring extra people with you. You like to have an extra forward in case somebody gets hurt so that you're not in a bind trying to get somebody flown in for a game. You do the same thing with defense. Scott Harrington is here as the extra defenseman, so the Blue Jackets are set in that category. But Bjorkstrand didn't play badly in the 2 games that he played, but it's not an even trade to take Foligno out and put Bjorkstrand in at this point of the season or this point in either one of their careers, to be completely honest with you. So Nick Foligno returns tonight. That's good news for the Blue Jackets. They opted not to come out here on Sunday, which was the original plan. They were going to play at home on Saturday against the Islanders, then come out here on Sunday, spend yesterday, and then play today. But I think it just with the travel and just the way things work. I know last week they had 3 days off, but you look what's coming up and the number of games that are coming up and the number of opportunities you're going to get to actually take a breath at home, because next week you may say, well, there's three home games, and then there's a day in between games one and two, so there's plenty of time at home. Listen, a game day is not a day at home, okay? It's not a day where you can just breathe and relax, spend time with your family. It's a work day. Whether you have a morning skate or you don't have a morning skate, it's still a work day, and John Tortorella realizes that. That's why they stayed home Sunday and then came out here yesterday after a practice at Nationwide Arena yesterday. Come out here yesterday. They'll play this game tonight, then move on to Calgary, and the next game is not until Friday. We'll get to that in a couple of minutes, too. But I want to start things off, as I always do, getting ready for a game with my exclusive interview with the head coach of the Blue Jackets, John Tortorella. You want to know what he thinks about Oliver Bjorkstrand's play? You want to know what he thinks about Connor McDavid and how they can stop him tonight, or if they can stop him? The head coach is about to tell you. All year, your team has been a third-period team. They have said that, you've said that, but how impressed were you? I was really impressed with what they did in the third period the other night. How impressed were you standing behind the bench?
Yeah, it was a well-played game going into the third. And there you go, as I've talked about. I think we overread the back-to-backs. I think us playing back-to-back helped us in the third period, because I think your second win's there. You're just flowing. You're not overthinking. You're trying to play simple and hard. I don't think we start the period off well. Really a lackluster power play. But we get a very lucky break and a major turnover right after they kill that penalty and Andy scores. I think that gave us some juice. And then the guys just played. So the back-to-back stuff is overrated. It really is. I think it almost helped you.
I think it was about this time last year, I was at an appearance with you. When it was over, we were talking, and you were just talking about your team, and you said, we're going to change what's going on in that room, because it wasn't very good at that point in time. So I'm going to ask you about a year later, have you changed the culture here?
I think we're taking, and it's not me, it's us, I think we're taking steps in the right direction. I think we're going to face some adversity along the way here in a long, long season. I think there are going to be tests as we go through, especially after Christmas when you get into some dog days. Holidays are over and you still have 4 months to play. We're taking the right steps, I think. I think they've bought into how we're trying to practice, how we're trying to play the game, coming to work every day. That's a step in the right direction as far as what I saw last year. I think there was some entitlement in this room. I still think there's a little of that still that we're trying to bang away. So culture, as I've said to you many times, culture and accountability, great summer words. They sound fantastic. It is a day-to-day business in creating it and staying with it. So now we've had a little success. Now the hard part is staying with it. So let's see where it goes.
I asked Brandon Dubinsky after the game the other night if he's ever been on a team that performs late in the game like this team does, and he said yes, when I was with the Rangers and Torts was the coach. Do you see the similarities?
A little bit. It was when we got there, we started developing our own players. We had some youth in there. We were still trying to find our way. And Doobie was one of those main pieces there as a younger guy, obviously. And we really... from our camp right on, we stressed conditioning level and what that means to you. So very, very similar as far as some of the third periods we played there in New York for a couple of years.
Earlier in the year, you won games with Seth Jones out with an injury. You won your last two without Nick Foligno, your captain. How important is it to come through those stretches, however long they may be, and have success without guys like that?
Yeah, you got to move right by your injuries no matter who. And those are two pretty key guys for us. You can't pine about it. You just got to move on. It gives other people chances in certain minutes. It gave me a great opportunity to see Oliver, to see where he is after. Really, I'm disappointed he wasn't with the team when we broke camp. I was hoping he was going to be with us. Didn't earn a spot here. Made some really good plays. You can see how the puck follows him. So it gives us a chance to look at some of more of our kids. And it puts other guys in situations that those guys have played in. And it makes your team better as you go through some of the injuries throughout the long year.
Is Bjorkstrand a hard read for you? Because I know we always have that saying that you can't teach heart, but I don't think he doesn't have heart. I think he just seems like one of those flatline guys where he's always the same. Would you agree?
Yeah, you got to be really careful how you judge a guy. he's not a Brandon Dubinsky who's out of his mind half the time and wears his heart on his sleeve. Oliver is still a young kid, very quiet, very respectful. I watched him in that American League playoff. I saw how he could play. I don't think he totally showed that during camp here this year, and that's why he's down. I saw a better Oliver Bjorkstrand, though, in the last couple of games here in that manner. It's never going to blow up at you like, man, look at the bite on that guy. He's just not built that way, but he was harder on pucks. He was much more determined, and I think that's a really big thing that he has to be more consistent in his game.
I'm not going to agree with you totally. I think you can do it because I've seen you do it with Brandon Saad in the last 6 weeks. He's a different guy.
Saad is a different bird, yeah. I've said this right along. I want some personality on our team. I want some guys to maybe miss a curfew, we don't even have curfew, or do something stupid to where, I mean, what are you thinking of? Have a coach come at you. I think it's good for things to happen with your team. Sauter is still probably mad at me. He didn't agree, and I was going to take him out because he wasn't playing hard enough. He simply was not playing hard enough, and he probably still doesn't agree with me, but he's playing harder.
Right. You took him from a flatliner guy to a guy that's playing with his heart on his sleeve now.
Yeah, he can be a really good player in this league just by playing. If he wants to be a great player, he has to stay on top of himself on just what we're talking about here. The competitive edge and the mind of being ready to go all the time because he falls asleep. And it's just his personality. But he is one hell of a player when he's on, and he has shown that here the past few weeks.
All right, one last thing. I know you don't like to talk about other teams, but I know that you watch everything that goes on and you're passionate about this game. This Connor McDavid that you're going to be facing, how important is he to the game itself, and how dynamic is this kid?
Yeah. Him leading the way with some of the youth in the league has just been fantastic. I've watched him a couple times. Haven't seen him too much live. We watch video. You don't stop him. To try to contain him, you got to get to him early because he is tough to stop if he has a head of steam. His skates don't touch the ice. I watched him the other night go after a guy in Philly there. There was some conversation as far as Manning and him. It's nice to see a young guy stick up for himself, too. And a star in our league, he stuck up for himself, not someone else doing it for him. I think that's part of maturity of young players, not looking for someone else to do that dirty work. And I don't know him. I hope I don't get to know him that well here tomorrow night. But I respect how he's handled himself, and especially that little situation with the Philadelphia defenseman. And I'm not sure what's true and what was said, but at least he stood in for himself. I think that's really important for our young guys to do.
Do you have to handle him like Ovechkin? Do you have to get to him early before he gets out of his zone?
Yeah. He's more dynamic than Ovechkin. He's just dangerous. And if we can limit his time and space before he gets full sails going, that's going to give us a better chance. We're not going to stop him. You don't stop him. It's just trying to contain him.
Yeah. I was going to say that sounds like accountability in the summer. If we can limit his time and space, good luck.
Yeah. Thank you. I'll let you know how it goes after.
And you can hear the Torts has great respect for Connor McDavid, and you have to have respect for this kid. Just the way he plays the game, the way he goes about his business. He's got 12 goals and 27 assists in 31 games coming into this one tonight. So he will be the focal point. Jody Shelley and I were talking with Mark Letestu, former Blue Jackets forward, earlier today over at the arena, and Letestu gets a chance to play on the power play with Connor McDavid, and he said he is so smart. He is already thinking three steps ahead of where he is, so you have to up your game thinking-wise. You have to be thinking the same way as he is, or trying to think the same way he is, if it's possible, because he's going to get the puck to you, and you've got to be ready. And as Mark said, those are your goals. He's going to put it there for you. If you miss out on it, that's all on you. Those are your goals. You have to be ready. You have to be thinking. So he is a very dangerous player, a young player, a dangerous player, the captain of this team, leads by example, no question about that. So it'll be fun to watch him. It'll be more fun if the Blue Jackets can contain him tonight. And as you just heard Torts kind of chuckling about it there, you know, it's a good luck thing. Good luck. because you can try every trick in the book, and it still might not be enough against this guy. We're going to find out what the Blue Jackets are able to do against him in just a couple of hours. Sam Gagner returns to Edmonton, where he was picked number 6 overall by the Edmonton Oilers back in 2007. Actually, he was picked at Nationwide Arena in Columbus, but he was a 6th overall pick. He played here for a number of years. There were good times, there were bad times, and then he wound up leaving, and since he's gone to Arizona, he's gone to Philadelphia, now he's in Columbus. I had a chance to catch up with him yesterday, right after he was named the number 3 star of the week in the NHL.
Sam, first of all, you were named number 3 star of the week, so congratulations. Did you know that?
No, I didn't.
Well, there, good. I'm glad I get to break good news. Yeah. So, but congratulations, and just a big week for you. And for you, just like everybody else in here, it's not about a big week. It's about just playing game by game, isn't it?
Yeah, I think we've had a really good mindset this year of doing that. Whether we win or lose, we're focused on the next game and controlling what we can control. And I think it's a big reason for our success this year. So hopefully we can continue to do that.
You are coming back to the place where it all began for you. Actually, what's really funny is it began in Columbus. That's where you got drafted, in Columbus. Right, yeah. And then you went to Edmonton to start your career. A little bit ironic, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, it's crazy how everything comes full circle. But, I really enjoyed my time in Edmonton. I think you make a lot of friends. And, you look back fondly on, everything that happened. So, it's definitely exciting to come back here. And hopefully we can get a win.
The only thing that's going to be different is you're not going back to the old building. You're not going to Rexall Place. You're not going back to the building with all that history. Brand new building here, and a place they're trying to make some new history. But I know it's been a long time coming for this city, and it's got to be great for them.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be great for the downtown. I just know from talking to a few of the guys that I used to play with, and they're really enjoying it, and it's great for the city. So it should be fun to play in it, and I'm looking forward to it.
Well, beyond the guys that you used to play with, what about the one guy that is not only the focus of this Oilers team, but the focus of the NHL, really, in many regards, Connor McDavid? You've got your forward, but you've got defensive responsibilities. If you happen to end up on the ice at the same time as him, which I imagine at some point you will, what have you guys talked about as far as trying to slow this guy down?
Yeah, I mean, his transition speed is best in the NHL. I don't think there's even a doubt, so I think that's something that you really got to focus on is making sure that you're making good puck decisions. But for us, I think the more we can play in their end, the less effective their entire team becomes. And I think we've done a pretty good job of that, and pushing the pace and going and playing the other team's end, and hopefully we can continue to do that.
You guys have great confidence as a team in the third period, but what you did against the Islanders the other night was, well, that was really kind of over the top. And when Josh Anderson scored that goal, was that kind of like the dam breaking where you guys said, okay, we're on top, now let's go?
Yeah, I don't even think you think about that. You just continue to push forward and try and get the next one and try and have a good next shift. And I think we're a team that, we roll four lines and we come at you in waves. And I think it's a big reason for our success. So I think we've done a really good job being a good third period team, and hopefully we can continue to do that.
Just put the puck in that. Yeah. You don't have to speak, right? Yeah. Just put the puck in that. Yeah. One last thing for you. The other night you scored an empty net goal. Like, things are really going your way, because usually when a puck gets up on end and it starts rolling like a tire, it goes away from the net. Yours was a perfect curve right into the middle of the net. What do you think of when you're watching that?
I was just trying to flip it out and make sure that we could live to fight another day, and fortunate that it was able to go in the net. But I think you have to enjoy that responsibility of being on the ice when the goalie's pulled for the other team. And I think for myself, it's just you enjoy that defensive responsibility, and it's nice to get rewarded there.
And I guess what goes around comes around, because against the Islanders, you try to flip one, it hits Josh Bailey's stick, and it winds up finding its way in the net. Kind of one of the flukier goals I've ever seen.
Yeah, it's a tough play. I mean, I don't think Bob saw it until kind of the last second. And for myself, it's just about making a stronger play on the wall and getting it to the D-man in the middle, and then those things don't happen. So you learn from learn from those things, even though it was unlucky, and you try to get better.
Well, Sam, thank you very much. I appreciate it. Enjoy your day in Edmonton. I'm sure you're going to be a pretty popular guy here.
All right, thank you.
Sam Gagner is one of those guys that just is a likable person. When we got over to the arena this morning, you could see people on staff, whether it was their training staff, the equipment managers, PR staff, guys that were seeking him out just to say hi, shake his hand, a very likable guy. And for him, he gets a chance to come back here and play a game tonight, and he's very appreciative of it. You know, he's playing well. That's a good thing. He's playing on a team that is playing well. He met with the media over there this morning and had a big throng of media around him, and deservedly so. Deservedly so, for a guy that they liked when he was here, but they just didn't like him enough, and now they have a great appreciation for what he's doing this season. So that was very good to see, and I hope Sam Gagner does some really good things tonight. I hope he comes in here and does things that the fans don't expect him to do that helps the Blue Jackets in a big, big way. Let's talk about the overall matchup here tonight. Of course, the Blue Jackets are 17-5-4, 38 points on the season for them. The Edmonton Oilers, they're right there. They're 15-11-5. They've got 35 points. But do the math, and you can see that the Edmonton Oilers have played more games than the Blue Jackets have. In fact, their head coach, Todd McClellan, said that today. He said, we're basically 2 weeks ahead of the Blue Jackets when it comes to playing games. A lot of people are starting to say this stuff now. You know, the Blue Jackets have, what, 5 games in hand on Philadelphia. They've got a couple on the Rangers, a couple on the Penguins. You know what? I'm sorry. I don't care. I don't care. I don't want to hear any of this stuff, because it has been the Blue Jackets for all these years that have been on the other side. Now they're finally on a favorable side. Look, listen, let's just look at this trip to begin with, okay? Game tonight. That's Tuesday. Game tonight in Edmonton. Don't play in Calgary till Friday. Don't play in Vancouver until Sunday. Now, albeit, that's an afternoon game. But how many times have we come out here and had to play 3 games in 4 or 5 days? Maybe not 4, but 5 days. And I don't know if I've ever been out here where we played Edmonton and Calgary with a gap in between. It's usually you play in one night, you play in the other the next night, because they're so close. It's a very short flight from one to the other. So, you know, this is a break. I was joking with somebody today, and I said, this is the schedule that the Pittsburgh Penguins get, that the New York Rangers get, that the big teams get. They come out to the West Coast, and they're out there for 10 days, and they play 3 games. They go on the Western Canada trip. They're out there for 8 days. They play 3 games. So this is a luxury. I'll grant you that. It is a luxury. And this is an Edmonton Oilers team that has played a ton of games in a short period of time, but I think they're starting to whine about it. And I don't mean the team. I don't mean the coach. I don't mean the team. I mean the people that cover the team. And I'm going to give you some examples about that, or of that, I should say. I'm going to give you some examples right now. Let's look at today's Edmonton Sun, okay? This is the game day matchup, Oilers versus Blue Jackets. And I'm just going to go right down through this. You know, it talks about their records and blah, 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 all this stuff. But then it gets to this breakdown. It says, in the tank, Edmonton half. Oilers capping off a stretch where they play 8 games in 13 days. Wah. Columbus, full tank. Blue Jackets are enjoying a leisurely stretch of just 5 games in 14 days. Where do you people think that this catches up? Do you think it never catches up? Do you think the Blue Jackets are going to play 77 games and you're going to play 82 games? Somewhere down the line, it's going to happen, okay? So what? Why is this an issue? Matchups. Let's see. Forwards, Edmonton. Hot and cold, but 4th overall in goals scored. Defense, Columbus. Some excellent young pieces who don't give up much. Very good. I like that. Goaltending, Columbus. Can't argue with numbers. Bobrovsky is putting up. Okay. Power play, Edmonton. Jackets ranked 1st overall, but Oilers 10 for their last 23. That should be a good matchup to watch those two units tonight. Penalty kill, Edmonton. It's been a solid spot for the Oilers all season. The Blue Jackets will have their work cut out for them against that penalty kill unit tonight, for sure. Then it says intangibles. That goes to Columbus. 6-game win streak equals serious momentum. Okay. Overall, Columbus. Oilers up against a fresher team that's on a roll. How about just a team that's on a roll? A fresher team. Oh, they're a fresher team. Oh, we've played more games in a shorter period of time. I'm sorry. I don't care. Why are you setting it up like this? And this is what media does. And I don't consider myself a part of the media because I work for the team. But this is excuse-making 101. Now, what happens if the Oilers come out and win this game tonight? Then they're fantastic. They're great because they overcame all this stuff. It drives me crazy. In any event, you know, the Blue Jackets, if you read this, they've got a great advantage tonight. The Blue Jackets have a great advantage because they're a great team. The Blue Jackets have a great advantage because they believe in themselves. All the things we talked about yesterday on this show, the confidence, the execution, the work ethic, the heart, the drive, the desire. That's why the Blue Jackets have the best chance to win this game tonight, I think. You look at what the Oilers have done in their last five games, what they're 1-1-3, I think, in their last five games. They found ways to lose the last handful of games. They're playing well overall, don't get me wrong. They're playing well overall, but they found a way to lose. They're in a little bit of a skid, so all of a sudden it's, well, there's not enough practice time. Well, there's a lot of games. Well, there's a lot of travel. Well, welcome to the NHL. Welcome to the NHL. That's how it is. That's how it's going to be for everybody. At some point, you're going to wear it. And the Blue Jackets, they just wore it. We just went through a stretch playing a whole bunch of games in a short period of time. And if you win them, nobody complains about it. As soon as you start to slip, then there is complaining. John Tortorella also had to answer, didn't have to, but he did answer, a whole ton of questions again today from the media here about the no morning skate. Can I just tell you how sick I am of the no morning skate? Not of the situation, of the questions about it. Listen, it's working, and it's almost as though there's a fear, not a fear amongst players and coaches of other organizations, not a fear amongst players and coaches of this organization. There's a fear out there, and the fear is in the media. I saw a tweet today from, this is a big-name writer in Edmonton. I'm not going to say his name, but he's a big-name writer. Might even be in the Hall of Fame, to be honest with you. And he sends out a tweet that says, with teams like Columbus practicing at home and then flying in night before the game and not having a morning skate, how are we supposed to get access to the players, or how are we supposed to ask questions, whatever it said, something like that. Basically, it was, oh, we can't get what we need. We can't get the players in the morning. We need it. Look, you're going to get them at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, 4:30, 5 o'clock, whatever. They have to be available at some point in time. Just because it doesn't fit a schedule where you want to have your story written the night before to run in the morning paper. Do people still get papers? I still get one on my porch. Sometimes I never even take it out of the doggone thing, and I end up throwing it away, and I get it. You know why I get it? So I can go online and get the access online, because it's cheaper to pay to get the thing thrown on the porch 3 days a week and be able to go look online anyway. I use the app. I don't even use the paper. But anyway, that's just me. So they want to have this thing done at their convenience. Well, I'm sorry. It's not your convenience. And times change. Times change, and you have to roll with the changes. And I do think that there is a little bit of fear out there from people watching the Blue Jackets do it this way and watching it be successful and knowing that there are plenty of other coaches and players and general managers that want to do the same thing. They want to have the guts to pull the trigger and do the same thing and haven't been able to do it. But you're always looking for an excuse. This is a copycat league, and you see one team that's doing this stuff and they're winning. Well, why do we have to do it? Well, you know, that's a good point. And Torch just throws it out there. He's very honest about it. He goes, listen, we bring our players in once a day to practice, and then on a game day, we're going to bring them in twice. We're going to bring them in the morning to skate, and then we're going to bring them back in the afternoon to play a game. That's stupid. That's stupid. Just bring them in one time. Have your meetings, play your game, keep yourselves fresh. You know, same thing. The Oilers, they're sitting here writing all this stuff about how tired they are. Well, I don't know. Cut out a couple of morning skates. Cut out a couple of practices. Give your guys some time off. And I'm sure Todd McClellan is doing that to where he can. He's a very good coach. I don't mean to sound like I'm ripping on him by any means, because I'm not. I respect him. He's a good coach. It's these writers and the TV guys and the radio guys that are whining about not getting the access that they want, and they should have it. That's just wearing on me over the last couple of weeks. Everywhere we go, everybody wants to talk about the morning skate. Look, it's working. I worked in baseball, so it's not that big a deal to me. You came in for batting practice at 4:15, 7 o'clock game, batting practice. If you were the home team, you went 4:15 to 5:15. Then the visiting team got it 5:15 to 6 o'clock. Then you got 15 minutes of infield. They got 15 minutes of infield. Then they line the field, they spray it down, and you play 30 minutes later. It wasn't a big deal. You come in one time. If you had extra work to do, you came in earlier. You went out on the field at 3:30. And from 3:30 until 4 o'clock, you worked on ground balls or whatever you did. That's how it works, and you play there every day. You're doing something here every day. This is very much, you know, you don't have a game every day, but there is something going on every day. Case in point, I'll tell you this. Tomorrow, the Blue Jackets are going to go to an Olympic training facility in Calgary, and they're going to do their workouts there. They're not going to skate. They're going to go and work out there. So there's something going on tomorrow. Then on Thursday, they're going to skate. And at the rink, and they're going to do it early in the morning, so there's something going on there. There's no day off there. And then on Friday, they're going to play a game, so there's no day off there. Saturday, I don't know. I don't know what way he's going to go with that, because there's an afternoon game Sunday. He might give them Saturday off, But I'm just saying, you're doing something every day. It's the same thing. Like, people look at schedules and go, oh, baseball plays every single day. Hockey doesn't play every day. Yeah, but there's something going on. They might be getting that one day a week off, but the baseball players are too, because it's mandated that they have to have a full day off every X amount of days. So, again, I just, it obviously rattles me. It obviously bothers me. And I didn't realize how much it bothered me until I started this whole conversation. I started reading these articles and all this stuff. But anyway, I'm done with that. I am totally done with that. And we'll see what happens tonight between these two teams. There are some key injuries here for the Edmonton Oilers. I will tell you that. And one of those key injuries is Darnell Nurse, one of their top defensemen. He's been out. I'm told that Jesse Puljujärvi will play tonight. And, of course, Puljujärvi was the guy that went fourth overall in this past summer's draft. He was the guy that everybody in the world thought that the Blue Jackets were taking, except Jarmo Kekäläinen. He thought he would like to have Pierre-Luc Dubois, and so that's what they did. So Puljujärvi, he hasn't played every game, I can tell you that. He's only played 22 games so far this year. He has one goal and seven assists, and that one goal came on opening night. Remember that? Go back and pull the show from after the Oilers' first game. I don't know if that was the same night the Blue Jackets played or not. Go back and listen to that CBJ and 30 and listen to me lament that, oh, we're going to hear this all year. This guy scored in his first game. We're going to hear about this. Dubois in the minors, and this guy's already scoring. Well, that's the last time he scored a goal, back in October. First week, second week. Now, me saying that will probably jinx the heck out of it. Knock on wood, it doesn't happen tonight. He doesn't get one tonight. But anyway, he's going to be in the lineup tonight, so he'll probably have a little bit of jump to him for that, you know? You know, he made some comments about wanting to come here, and here meaning Edmonton, instead of going to Columbus and all that stuff. So we'll see. Maybe he's got a little bit of an edge tonight. But here's the bottom line. If you don't control Connor McDavid, and I'm not saying stop him, as you heard Torts say, you can't stop him. Torts is like Dan Patrick. You can't stop him. You can only hope to contain him. But if they can contain him, that'll change the game tonight. Mark Letestu said as soon as he starts speeding up, he draws two guys to him, at least sometimes three. Then you've got guys open all over the place. So the Blue Jackets have to guard against that, especially with their young defense tonight. They've got to try to guard against that. But if you can control him, I think you can control the Edmonton Oilers. We're going to find out later on tonight. 9 o'clock game time this evening. You'll be able to hear the game on the Blue Jackets radio network with the flagship station in Columbus, 97.1 The Fan. Should be a good one. I've got to bundle up. And I understand things are not great back in Columbus, but it's not exactly great here. There is some sun today, but it's freezing cold. You always feel like your face is going to fall off. All you have to do is walk half a block here in Edmonton, and it's going to be no better in Calgary. But again, you don't want to hear it because I see there's things being canceled all over the place today, so I'm not going to harp on that. I'm not going to whine. I'm not going to whine like some other people that I've complained about on this show today. I will talk to you tonight, 9 o'clock from Rogers Place in Edmonton. Till then, Bob McElligott saying so long.